Hello everyone. Welcome to worship here at the East Church. Welcome if you're here in person and you know. Welcome if you're here in person and as we. Thank you. Long time since we've heard feedback. Welcome if you're here in person, and we usually at this point we kind of turn to each other and we can't take our masks off, but you can give each other a wave. Us, the church gathered. Hello everybody, yes. And welcome if you're watching on the live stream on Facebook or YouTube. It's great to have you with us, the church gathered. Also, if you're watching the recording on the website later, it's good that you can manage that too. We call it blended worship, and it looks as if it's set to carry on in some form for quite a while still, especially after the General Assembly earlier in the month. Technically, according to the Scottish Government guidance today, we're allowed to sing this morning from behind our masks, but I would ask you not to sing, since the church rules require us to have our risk assessment updated and approved by the Kirk Session before we can sing again. And there's not been time to do that yet. Now, I'm hoping to have that done for next Sunday, which is a communion Sunday. And this week, we rather tentatively start out on an exploration of the book of the Revelation. Now, some find it a strange book, constructed around patterns of numbers like threes, sixes, and sevens, and full of bizarre creatures. Some find it a scary book. Some wonder how it brings out the whole plot of the Bible. How it talks about the people longing for a homeland, exiled in Babylon, kept in Egypt, who wandered in the wilderness and journeyed to the promised land. They wonder about how that all fits in. We will discover as we read it through that Babylon and Jerusalem are shown as kind of mirrors of each other. We might ask why. Because this is a book, the Revelation, that requires close attention. And over the history of the Bible, some like Luther have even challenged whether it should be in the Bible, although it is on the oldest list of Bible books that we have. It's not a historical book for us today, since the history is written in code, the key to which we don't have. It's not prophecy in the sense of foretelling the future. So what is the book, and what should we be looking for? It's a vivid picture of the God of the past, the God of the present, and the God of the future. That's an example of the use of the number three by John in his book. And it's an example of how God is with us, always making order from chaos. In chapter 7, John tells us that never will we thirst, because the Lamb who is at the center of the throne will be their guide and will guide them to springs of the water of life. This sounds like something we might have read in John's Gospel, doesn't it? Or the water of life, the Lamb who guides. And that's maybe part of why so many believe it's the same John who wrote one day from the island Patmos to the churches, the book of the Revelation. The take-home message of all 22 chapters is that God controls everything and holds everything together, even when it seems he doesn't. So let us worship God today. Listen as Jennifer, accompanied by Muriel, sings "Morning Has Broken."
Breeze for the singing, breeze for the morning.
Let us join in prayer. Let us pray. Come, let us return to the Lord, for it is the Lord who will heal us. The Lord will bind us up. So let us lay before God now the ways in which we wound his love. May the Lord heal us and forgive us. May the Lord reconcile us to one another and to him. May the Lord send us out in love. So let us bow our heads for a few moments of quietness now, as we think about what God has done for us and how we've experienced him over the coming days and weeks. Gracious God, we are small, and your love makes us great. We are far away, and your love brings us near. We are hungry for healing, Lord, and your love fills our needs. So raise us to the new life that you offer, the eternal life, assured for us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our reading this morning comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verses 1 to 8, right at the beginning. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what soon must take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testified to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of the prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion for ever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. As you have just heard, today's reading comes from right at the very beginning of Revelation. And it begins a series of weeks in which we are going to travel through Revelation. Everyone knows there is a book right at the end of the Bible called Revelation, but less people know of its content, and even less are able to make sense of it. And I have to confess that I am one of these people. Well, I understand slightly more than I did. It's a very difficult book to read, with all sorts of strange images contained. Angels and demons, horned beasts, sometimes quite monstrous creatures. There's dragons and slain lambs with multiple eyes. These are but a few of the symbolic imageries found in the book. But to try to understand this, and I do say try because it's not going to be easy, to try to understand, we must first identify the structure, the themes contained, and how we're going to read it. Revelation is what's known as apocalyptic literature. The word apocalypse is from the Greek, meaning apocalyptus. It's usually translated into revelation. It means any sort of unveiling or uncovering of something. We sometimes hear it called the Revelation of John or the Apocalypse of John. Sometimes people are mistaken and think that the book is called Revelations, as in the plural, but actually it's singular, revelation. It refers to one great revelation, not several revelations. It's possibly the greatest revelation of all. And as I said before, it's an example of apocalyptic literature. It's not the only book in the Bible that's apocalyptic. The book of Daniel is our earliest example of this. So let's look more closely at the features and the structure of this type of book. They usually claim to be written by a famous holy character, set deep into the past. But in this case, we have no reason to believe that it wasn't written by John. Most scholars believe that it wasn't actually the same John of the Gospel. There are many arguments for and against this, but for my part, I find it quite unlikely that it is the same John. Points like the quality of Greek between the two, and the fact that the Gospel of John was unidentified by a writer. It was anonymous until much later. But that's just my opinion. You're entitled to form your own. Another point being, they usually narrate a chronological span of time. They claim to be a certain place or in a certain time, a certain state of mind, sometimes dreamlike, when an angel or another heavenly guide takes them somewhere, leads them. So, as we see here, an angel is sent from God to John. Here, he's then instructed to write his visions down. They're often expressed by a way of ancient cosmologies. Now that sounds difficult. It means things like the four corners of the earth, different layers to heaven and hell, the above and the below. But a main characteristic is what is known as dualisms. And this is just the two extremes of one point. There are ethical dualisms. The characters are either good or bad. The world contains good and bad angels. That might surprise you. Or good and bad men. They're rarely found to be anything in between. Sometimes there is what's known as a spatial dualism, in that what's happening here in the earth is only a mirror of what's happening above. Battling nations are only an earthly representation of the spiritual battles with the angels and the demons who are battling in the heavens. Lastly, there's a chronological dualism. Now this is quite important. We live in the now time, you and I, the time before the great event. With this event, it ushers us into the reign of God, the future, the great revelation. But before I look at the main structure of the book, I'll point out some of the main symbols. The most obvious are the relationship to the numbers. Four, the four corners of the earth, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, the four creatures around the throne. But the most significant of all, and it's so significant that we find it featuring in the Bible 54 times, sorry, in Revelation 54 times, is the number seven. Here are but a few of them. Seven stars, the seven letters to the seven churches, seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven bowls. The number seven is associated with completeness or perfection. The 7 days of creation that we read of in Genesis. There are many animals or beasts in Revelation. The four horses, each different colors. The first is white for the conqueror. The second, red for war. The third, black for a famine. And the final and fourth, which is green for death. The lamb and the lion, the sacrificial martyring, and the royal kingship of Jesus. Beasts, usually satanic features. The Roman emperor, related to the number 666. Horns, representing power. Wings, for mobility. There are many, many others. Women, which represent a nation of people or a city. Eyes, for knowledge. And many eyes represented a superior knowledge. The sharp sword, is to judge and to punish. A crown that is given to rule and to govern over everyone. So as you will see, the book's chaotic nature and its crazy creatures is really just a dramatic display of symbolism. Firstly, we're presented with today's introduction. John is exiled to Patmos. It's a prison island. He's exiled for not confessing and worshipping the Roman Emperor. At this time, it's thought to be Nero. So we have our exiled John there in Patmos, all alone, when an angel comes to him in a vision and shows him what is to come. He's instructed to write 7 letters to the 7 churches in Asia Minor. It's after these 7 letters, and notice there's our first significant 7. It's after this that the structure begins. It's a structure of cycles, almost like a spiral. The circles that come round and round again, each getting higher and higher, ramping up the action up to a climax. Then followed by, almost surprisingly, an anti-climax at the end. After the 7 letters to the 7 churches, we encounter 7 seals. That's the first cycle. The speed and the opening of each seal ramps up again. And the 7th is an anticlimax. The 2nd cycle, the sounding of 7 trumpets. The same climax and then anticlimax. We have a short interlude with chapters 12, 13, and 14, where we see things like the woman and the dragon. Then the 3rd cycle, the 7 angels that come with the 7 plagues. This is followed to the end with our final greatest conclusion, the great revelation that I spoke of at the beginning. So you will see from just those few points that a chaotic book filled with angels and monstrous beasts does in fact have a very strict structure, one which we're going to use over the next few weeks. This will help us to make sense of the book, to make sense of the symbols, all the raging battles that we're going to find amongst it. It may be full of things that we've never heard of before, and sometimes things that are very difficult to understand. But it's certainly dramatic, and it certainly holds your attention. So, if like many, you enjoy the Game of Thrones, I have to say that Revelation has got to be your next box set. Everybody's going to love it.
Thank you, Sarah. Now we're going to hear John Montgomery sing Spirit of the Living God. You need to plug in.
Fresh.
Just before I start my kind of reflection today, I'm going to utter a few words which I never thought I'd say in church. If you're feeling a bit warm today, I do apologise. We've had a lot of work, mainly done by David Lane, on the heating system, and David Maxwell as well with the new control systems, and we're still trying to work out exactly how it works. We can get it to work fine when it's a cold day outside, but there's still a few settings when it's warmer outside that we've got to grapple with. So don't expect it to be this warm every time you come to the East Church. It just wouldn't be church, would it, if you didn't have to have your cardigan? Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of your presence, open the mind of God to us, that in your light we may see light, and in your strength be strong. Amen. The opening of any book is important, isn't it? Important because you've opened it. But then again, important because you don't know what's going to happen when you read it through. You don't know whether you're going to enjoy it or find it informative. Now, the cover, that may give you some idea of what to expect, whether you'll gain knowledge or be entertained. But as my mother said, can you judge a book by its cover? Maybe what you really want is a book that informs and entertains, a book that enthralls as you learn, especially if you're indulging yourself in your hobbies. And as some of you know, I've got some strange hobbies. For a start, I'm a fan of St. Johnstone Football Club. Well, that's quite a good thing to be at the moment. I like growing licorice plants. You've seen that. I translate Dutch theology books for fun. And I love to think about how plants evolved. Now, if Stan puts up a picture, I've got two books next to each other on my shelves. One's called The Evolution of Plants, on the left there. Your left, and one is the phylogeny and evolution of the angiosperms, both about plants. Both seem to offer the same dry story when you look at the title, don't they? But what a surprise I got. One is quite difficult to read, but the other is a pleasant, well-written trip through a very complicated and hard to piece together story. The opening of any book is an important event. For you, yes, as you read it, and your expectations, but also for the person who wrote it. Questions in the author's mind might be, will people understand it? Will they finish it? Will it keep them enthralled and finish it? Have I written a book that enthralls and teaches? Will they pick up on what I'm trying to tell them? And I don't know whether John had those thoughts while he was writing down the Revelation, but I think he's managed to do just that, to entertain and enthrall. The book of the Revelation, as Sarah said, has a bit of a strange reputation. It has a reputation for being difficult to read, that it's ambiguous, a bit of a puzzle, because we've lost the key to how to read it. In other words, what that means, we can't understand it because we're not living in the first century under Roman rule, or we're not exiled on a prison island, cut off from our church friends. Or maybe we aren't. But if you read the Revelation with an expectation of a historical textbook, you will be disappointed. Similarly, while Revelation is one long prophecy, it tells us that right back at the beginning. If you approach it as you would Harry Potter say, again, you'll be disappointed. In Harry Potter, prophecy is about mapping out the future, what we call divination, working out what's going to happen. Revelation is a different type of prophecy. It makes us think through these images about how we live. It's written in a way that captures our imagination right there, makes us think. Right from the opening verse of chapter 1, it asks us personal questions. Because this, the book of Revelation, is a book of hope. It's about hope. God loves you, Jesus died for you, and because of that, he opened up hope for now and the future. And that's the hope that John is speaking about in the whole book. Here, John makes sure that while we will read an account of disorder and chaos, a Game of Thrones type book, as Sarah said, we will also discover that the book is about bringing in a neat order to things. The start of the book and the end are very similar. The book has a kind of circular frame around it. The story is circular, or as teachers now say, it spirals up, as Sarah said. It's a story of how everyone and everything is put in its correct place. That's what it's about. Just as my book on the phylogeny and evolution of flowering plants does that for plants. The time is near is part of this story of hope. We could put the next picture up, I think, Stan. All is well. The time is near. All is well. Everything will be put in its correct order at the appropriate time. So have patience. And what does John ask us to use to guide us? Well, both at the start of the book and at the end, we find the same kind of phrases, the Alpha and Omega, the A to Z. We discover that John's welcome news is of Jesus coming to make God's repairs to a broken world, nothing more, nothing less. And he says that at the start, and he says that again at the end. That is how the order is sorted out and filed away into our lives as hope. And the response to all those welcome words of hope at the start and end is simply, Amen. So be it. How often have you said Amen to that? Or heard someone else say Amen when you try planning for the future that you don't really know what's going to happen in? But if hope is the theme for John, why does he write it in such a strange way? The thing to grasp about the book right now, about the book of Revelation, the thing to put in your mind right now is, as Sarah said, it's an unveiling. It's an uncovering of something, if you like. An uncovering of something that was previously hidden, a revelation. And what is uncovered is a new, exciting point of view. That's what we're being offered here. The way that God himself views hope. So the expectation we have is that something will be uncovered for us, and that something can only be seen from above. This is a heavenly point of view, as Sarah said, for us to savor. That's what we're being given. That's what's being unveiled. That's what's being shown to us. That's the revelation. A view of hope. The hope of a new order as seen from above. It's God's point of view. And John describes how this viewpoint works. We can trust it because there is a communication chain, which Sarah told us about earlier. And back in my days at Midmar, we knew that when snow fell, the hill up to the church was very quickly blocked. So we had a telephone list that cascaded the closure of the church from the session clerk to all the members via the elders. And I think Burson Fuside have something similar at the moment. Here, the revelation, the uncovering of God's view of the future comes from Jesus. But Jesus has been given it by God. And an angel helps Jesus let John know what is being uncovered, unveiled, revealed. And then John tells us there's a communication chain from God. But remember, what he is always revealing is that there is hope for the future. Hope for the future. Not bloodshed and mayhem, although we're going to see a lot of that. There are seven reassuring beatitudes dotted through Revelation. They just appear. They seem unconnected. But if you step back and you see and you think about them, what you actually are seeing at those little 7 points in the story is kind of the gospel story laid out to the end of time through Beatitudes, blessed. The first beatitude we heard this morning is a personal one for us. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of the prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and keep what is written in it, for the time is near. What a reassurance that is, isn't it? This book that so many are frightened to read starts with a gift from God that as we hear or read it, we are being blessed here in 2021. We're being blessed with hope for the future which is near. All will be well. Chaos will be smoothed into order. But that has implications for us, doesn't it? When we hear, we have to act. We are good people of our country. But sometimes we have to take a stand. And the book of the Revelation is a vivid reminder that sometimes there is conflict between the church's view and others, whether it be about how to treat people or how we use materials. God's big challenge to us is to think about how the world works and then to ensure that when we follow the world's view, we do it. When we follow the world's view, we do it because it is God's way, because it is God's way. The book of Revelation contains lots of fights, conflicts, and bloodshed, and some of it is very disturbing to read. Yet here, at the start, we are reminded that there is comfort too, and ultimately, as we go through this revelation, as it's all unveiled, there is order. So John starts to develop his theme here, but as we read through the book, we should actually kind of have a bookmark, assuming we're using a book rather than a Kindle like I am, a bookmark reminding us that this is not a historical book. It is not about working out the future. This is about hope and ordering the world and offers us the comfort of God's presence today. The theme that unfolds is that God reigns in the future just as much as he did in the past and does now. God reigned in the past, he reigns now, and he will reign in the future. And it's easy to forget sometimes, as we face an uncertain future, that God is still in it. He's not just a God of the past or the present. He is God of our future too. The eternal God is ever present with us. And we can find peace and his grace looking back. We can find it in today's world, but we can find it too when we trust God with our future. Now, we all lead busy lives, don't we? And sometimes we come to the church just to rest, to sit in the pews for a while and rest from our busy lives. And what we're doing is we're kind of aligning our thoughts with the thoughts of God. And we sit and we feel his special, forgiving, guiding peace rain down on us. Just for a short while. To take back with us out into the world. Yet when we look at the uncertainties of the future, we can get really loaded down by the frightening unknown and all the many possibilities for change that might seem out of our control. And even when the changes are within our control, we can feel a bit disorientated, can't we? And as we look around the church at the moment, at the Church of Scotland at the moment, it's a bit like that at the moment, isn't it? Things don't seem to be arranged or organized as they were. Lockdown has been strange. We've had very great difficulty with keeping up with friends. The session has had great difficulty with keeping up with how people are in the community. Things aren't arranged or organized as they were. Online worship, which very few of us knew anything about, at the start of lockdown, has become something that we just do. And the more you do it, the easier it becomes, and maybe the more comfortable you feel about it, because that's good. Because I think online worship is here to stay. If you think about what was said at the General Assembly just recently. And the General Assembly is introducing more big changes too. Well, then again, maybe it's just putting it all back in the right order, like John is doing in the book of Revelation. So how do you feel about the future of the church? It's a very valid question to go away and think about. How do you feel about it? One of the thoughts that comes out of the General Assembly, and nobody's actually saying this in our presbytery at the moment, but when you work at the figures and things like that, it could be that just two ministers are going to work with four or five churches. How do we do that? There are five clusters. We're going to be allowed something like 10 parish ministers. How do we work? I'm not sure, but blended worship and streaming will be part of it. The buildings will be important too. The Sunday worship will never go away, but things are going to have to be a bit different. Now is the time, like never before, to grab the message of comforting hope that comes from knowing that God is uncovering his plan. That's what's happening. God doesn't just hold the past and the present in his hands. It's not just the past and the present. He is there in our future too. He points us to the future, and we don't face it reluctantly. We face it with hope and peace and comfort, even though we may not yet know what it will look like. Jesus was the faithful witness for God during his lifetime on earth. That's central to the book of Revelation. Jesus is the firstborn from the dead. We're told all this at the start of Revelation, and we're told it again at the end. Jesus has triumphed over death, and Jesus will be the ruler of the earth who brings us the hope for the future. And maybe to help stick that idea of hope in our minds, we can take the worship poem that John gives us to help us remember it. John says, Christ's death on a cross is God's divine love. That love that calls us into a kingdom that at present remains spiritual with lots of experiences of God for us to feel. Yet this same kingdom provides hope for a glorious future where everything is truly ordered and in its place in the world. It's the same Messiah who died on the cross who will return in glory for all to see. And maybe you're reminded of the well-known hymn, which has words which help us capture today's passage. It's hymn 671 in the hymn book. Verse 2 captures today's passage. Be still, my soul. Your God will undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Hold on to the hope, the theme that John is bringing out in the book of Revelation. Chaos, ordered hope. Let us pray. Gracious God, we sit here in your presence, thankful for the grace and peace that you bless us with, thankful that you are the one who is and who was and who will be our God always, who we feel through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, the one who freed us, the one who loved us and made us into a kingdom people, serving you, his Father and our God, the one we know as Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we move on to our time of reflection, when I'll ask Douglas in a moment to bring the offering down to the front. Today, as we bring the offering forward, John will be singing For the Fruit of the Spirit. And just a thank you to everybody who has been using the online giving and the card reader that we have at the front door. Just an update to what we can do with that now. The card reader at the door is now set up so that we can, if you want to give by gift aid, you can do that now. We've added that little bit to the card reader. So Douglas, if you bring the offering down, and we hear John singing For the Fruit of the Spirit.
For the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, for such there is no law. Yes, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, for such there is no law. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, for such there is no law.
Loving God, we offer you now our offerings of money, but of our time and our skills too. Help us be part of building the future, of making the hope reality as we move forward as the Church of Scotland and as Bangor East Church. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for your love, love made known in Jesus. We thank you for calling us to be friends, for showing us what mercy means and how your love can bring action throughout the world. Listen now to our own particular concerns for the world. We bring them to you, Lord, in a few moments of quietness. May we, your church, be faithful to our calling. Shield us from scorn and inspire us to proclaim the message that you have given us, the message of mercy and healing, and the new life that is open to all who come. Show us ways to develop your church here, ways that marry the traditional with the new, ways that above all bring out your love as we follow your command to follow you. And give light to the world where people claim their own way of life. Grant insight and humility to all in authority. Bless the parents in this community. Stir up their hearts to feel your call to follow you and to take a place in your church here in Bankery. Let the sick and the anxious feel your outstretched hand, such that they may feel the peace of knowing you. And as always, Lord, we thank you for our special memories of all who taught us of your love and who now sit in your presence praising you through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us when we pray to say together quietly from behind our masks, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And just a quick reminder before we have the closing music and the benediction that, as usual, we'll be exiting from these two doors. And if you wait until David has got that door organized and brings you forward, or Sarah on that side, we'll bring you forward, just like we normally do. And there is sanitizer at the doors. So we finish this morning. Our closing music is hymn 279, which is Make Way, and it's a violin and piano trio that we've got playing. Go out now, return to the world, go knowing that God is not just the God of the past. He's not just with us here in the present. He is our hope for the future too. Go, tell others of that marvelous message. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all this day and forevermore.